song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Check, 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 check. Somebody say hallelujah. Our God is an awesome God. Well, okay, my God is awesome. I don't know about yours, but my God is an awesome God. He's a God that gives life and not death. Hey, man, Bobby McDonald, I've been looking for you. Glad to see you, my brother. Hallelujah. Amen. Why don't you guys stand to your feet, please? And I want you to do me a favor. First of all, I want to thank you for coming tonight. I tell you, this is just it's just God's encouraging us to push in this season when everything seems to be shaking. This is solid ground right here, the church. Come on. Everything in your life that can be shaken will be shaken, so that the only thing that remains is what is of God, and what is of God cannot be shaken. Is that right? How many of you know him tonight? If you know him, then you're not shaken. Come on. Come on. There is a life that conquers death. We are people of resurrection. I love Easter. How about you? It's not Easter. It's Passover. But Resurrection Sunday, I love to celebrate the resurrection of Christ because it speaks to life. It speaks to life. My God is a God of life, and I love to celebrate. I don't know if the battery may be dying here. Have y'all changed batteries? Maybe I was just standing in a bad spot. It was in and out, in and out. Amen. Lift your hands. Let's love on him. Father God, we bless you tonight. I thank you for this people. I thank you, Father God, that those that are tuning in on Facebook, those that are here in person, Holy Spirit, I'm just asking you right now to reach your hand out and to touch and to heal and to save. Father God, I thank you for the fire that is building in your church, not just 709 West Mulberry, but in your church there is a fire of God that is building. And Holy Spirit, I just invite you right now, come in and have your perfect way. Thank you for this worship team. I pray your anointing upon them. I thank you that the Word of God is already anointed. But Father God, anoint the man of God as he delivers what is on your heart. We want to hear from heaven tonight. And Father, we're going to give you thanks and praise and glory for it. Bless this time now in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. All right, this is Friday night. It ain't no big deal. You just get loose, get free. Is anybody free in here?
Amen.
Come on. I want you to be free. Come up here, worship. Let's have church.
Amen. Amen. Y'all stay standing. Y'all come up to the front. Y'all come up to the front. It's time to get a little bit uncomfortable. Amen.
I don't know.
Ready?
There is joy in the house of the Lord.
Sandaraye. Come on, just lift your voices to him tonight. You came here on a Friday night not to just sing these praises, but to worship him, to receive what he has for you. So just jump in the river. Jump in the river tonight. There is joy in this house. There is peace in this house. We praise you, God. We praise you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We praise your name. We praise your name. We praise you, Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy. Come on, y'all. Come on. Come on. Just lift your hands.
Hallelujah.
Be the glory. Hallelujah. when we cry out to you, God, because you are joy, you are peace. You are the mighty river. You are the mighty river. We just praise your name, Father God. We praise your name, Father. I pray that you just let your fire fall in this room tonight, Father. Every person that's listening or watching, Father God, that your fire fall upon them, Father God. Lord, that you grab a hold of them, Father God, that they could see you in a new light tonight, Father. Lord, those that are hurting, those who are going through situations that seem impossible, Father God, grab a hold of them tonight and show your love, God. Show your love to them, Lord. Jesus, we praise your name. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
To see.
to see you. You're holy, 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 holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Just sing it one more time. You are holy, holy, holy. Lift your voice.
Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you.
You're holy, Lord. You're such a good Father, Lord. We praise you, Jesus.
Faithful. and I will sing of the goodness of God. And I will sing of the goodness of God. It's time to die.
up to the heavens. That's what I see right now. It's like this whirlwind right here, right here, right here. Your praises are just being, they're just going up. I see them. I see the angels just taking them up. They're not just hitting the ceiling. Your prayers are not just hitting the ceiling. They are reaching the throne room tonight. So we're going to glorify his name.
Fill my life till the only thing is you, Lord, glorify your name.
I'm not
business real quick. Amen. Let's take care of somebody. You know, we don't have to wait. The Lord is you know, I think that sometimes we get stuck on methods, you know? We just think that certain things need to happen before the Lord shows up, right? Or we're so used to being set free after the preaching. How about we get set free right now? Yeah? How about we just go there now? The Lord is showing me, and the pastor just told me the same thing, and I was like, all right, that's it, I'm going. You know? He showed me this. Listen, if you've been struggling, okay, with things in your life that have been just knocking you down and knocking you down and knocking you down, we need to take care of that right now. Amen. The Lord is going to do a work in your life where you've been trying to break free, you've been trying to break loose, you've been trying to stand up, and you've been struggling. The Lord wants to eradicate that right now in this moment. But the thing is that, let me share a little personal story. Last Sunday, and you guys like steak? I like steak. I like steak a lot. We're at the point where, like, with our kids, we were trying to, like, teach them, like, the farm animals and stuff. So they call steak cow. It's cow. And last Sunday, we went out to a steakhouse, and it's just, you know, roadhouse in, like, Jackson, and you know, the butter bread came out. That was super good, right? You know what I'm talking about? Those rolls with like the what was it, like a cinnamon honey butter. Probably shouldn't be talking about food though. My stomach's going. And that came out and that was good. But I had ordered this like 16-ounce ribeye, right? And I was just so excited for it. And I ordered a cup of chili just to kind of get me started. You know, kind of get my engine moving. And the first bite I took out of that chili, my tooth cracked. It sent pain down to my soul. I just about cried at the table. You guys ever had like some really bad tooth? Man, some of you guys are like, yes, I know exactly what you're talking about. And I was just about to cry. And one of the first things that came into my mind was like, I still got a 16-ounce steak to eat somehow. You know what I'm saying? Like you can't just waste that. But it was hurting me, so and it's still till and every day now, until I go to dentist tomorrow. I mean Monday. I'm sorry. It's been bothering me so much. But you know what I noticed this. I noticed this, that it didn't really matter. Cause so, you know, sometimes my muscle memory, it betrays me, and it goes to this side, and when I crunch down, it's like it just happened all over again. But you know what I noticed? Even though the pain, the struggle is there, my appetite is not suppressed. I'm going to say that again because you guys didn't get it, okay? Even though I got a broken tooth, I'm still hungry. Are you following what I'm saying? And so I'm not the kind of guy that does very well without eating, okay? So I'm going to find a way. I'm going to make a way. I'm going to train myself to eat on this side because I'm hungry, even though this side is broke, even though this side is cracked, even though this side is not perfect. And if I take a bite on this side, I just don't want to eat anything for the rest of the day, but that pain goes away. And I go back to eating on this side. Here's what I'm telling you. Are you hungry for God? Are you hungry for God? Or have you come here to patty cake? Or are you truly hungry for the presence of God? For the Spirit of God to infill you, transform you, and get rid of things in your life because of the fire that is going to trim you? See, it doesn't matter if you got a cracked tooth today. If you're hungry, you'll find a way. If you're hungry, you'll find a way. And that's what we're going to do right now. If you're hungry, find a way. We want to pray with you. We want to lay hands on you. Move now. If you're hungry, move now. Respond. 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 Go ahead.
Lord, go have by your
So take us in to your secret place. Take us in to your secret place. Take us in to the secret place and wrap us in your arms, God. Take us in to your secret place. Take us in to your secret place. Take us in to your secret place and wrap us in. Secret place and wrap us in your arms, God. Take us in to your secret place. Take us in to your secret place. Take us in to your secret place and wrap us in your arms.
We wanna come closer to you. We wanna see you.
We want.
Embarrass a few of you guys. Is that okay? Is that okay? You guys okay with that? Can you come over here for a minute? Yeah, you. That's good. That's good. Relax. Chill out. This is what I... Were you trying to get my attention? Yeah, whichever one you want. You tell me what you want. This is what I hear. Locked and loaded. I see a birthing of ministry. Like it's never happened before. The thing is that you've been locked and loaded for a while. But you gotta give. It's almost like this church is weird. They're crazy. When I'm telling you, when I say lock and loaded, everybody goes like this. This is that kind of church. But you know what would be kind of pointless is if every single one of us in here we're like, yeah, we're going to church and I'm gonna take my pistol, right? And then when we all showed up to church, we all just locked it up in the office, right? Like, all right, guys, bring your guns. We're gonna lock them in because we're fixing the house, so let's lock them up. And then something happens and everybody's guns are over there, right? The thing is that a gun is pointless unless it's in the right hands. You've been locked and loaded for a while. You just gotta let the Lord just grab a hold of you and begin to aim and shoot. And begin to aim and shoot. There's a warfare going on in your life. But the Lord is saying, if you just let me get a hold of you and aim and shoot, you will see the strongholds come down. And when those strongholds that are keeping you in come down, you're going to step out. And you're going to step out like you're from like a Rambo movie. You're just going to show up and just start locking and then unloading on the enemy. I hope this is making sense to you. Praise Jesus. Let me lay hands on you. Can I get some ladies to come help me? Come on. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You know, you asked me what was happening Sunday night, what we were teaching on Sunday night, and I said probably teaching about the fire. But you don't have to wait till Sunday night. You can get a hold of it right now. Amen? Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that there will be a fire like never before in our life. Fill her up, Jesus. Ina mana shokata tata shekene mene. Ina la mana shokata ra mata ta shekete ra mara sakata ra shata ne mere shere. Ina la shokata ra shata ra mara sakata ra mara shere. In your hands, Lord. She's in your hands, Lord. Use her, Jesus. Use her, Jesus. Use her, Jesus. Use her, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I pray for your husband. I pray that the Lord would shower him with his presence and words of knowledge will begin to flow. That he would show up to places of business, interviews, at HEB. And the Lord will begin to speak to him like never before. He will begin to see things and begin to declare things. You can trust that man of God, the Lord says. You can trust him. The Lord's working. Thank you, Jesus. for being brave. Thank you, God. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. I don't think I've met you yet. Have I met you yet? Hi, I'm Pastor G.
I'm Mindy.
Nice to meet you, Mindy. God loves you so much. You know, it bugs him to see you in pain. It bugs him to see you like in bondage, like in a cage, trapped. I don't know. You correct me if I'm wrong, but I hate depression. I hate it with a passion because it's not of God. And if you're a daughter of the King, then it's not yours either. You don't have to walk around here believing the lies of the enemy. Jesus paid the ultimate price for you to be free. Thank you for the blood. I thank you for the blood, Jesus. You're covered. You don't have to leave here with that depression. I'm sorry if I'm embarrassing you, but you know what? God just loves us too much to care about that. Lord, embarrass me. Bring it on, you know? I just want that freedom so that bad. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, come on, ladies, y'all come help me. Come on, y'all. Don't sit down. Y'all quit sitting down. Y'all stay over here. Follow me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God loves you so much. God loves you so much. Depression, break in the name of Jesus. There's no place for you in the kingdom of God. And this daughter belongs to the King. Get your paws off of her, devil. Be free, be free, be free. You're not a second-rate Christian. You're not a second-rate daughter. You're called, anointed, equipped. Ha ha! You're loved. You're pursued. Ah. God is pursuing you. He's relentless. He's relentless. Ara shota ta me sheka ta ta shoka ineshe tamato ela shoka na mata ta sheketara inana manana sokoto to shaka tarara shatarara holo shaka ta na shekera mata ta ta. Father, even take those memories away in the name of Jesus. Peace of mind, freedom, a clean slate in her mind. Yes, Jesus, thank you for freedom. 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 I would even be more undignified than this. Even more undignified. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Ara shota na mata ta shoko tara la shetere mere shetera. When you get up from this place, you're gonna get up and you're gonna grab your tiara and you're gonna put it back on. And no demon in hell can take it away. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. By you. We worship you, Jesus. We worship you, Jesus. You go, boy. Get it, get it. If we don't, they will. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for this generation. Pray for breakthrough, Jesus. Thank you for the joy of the Lord. Out of mouth of babes, Jesus. Proclaim it. Proclaim it and do it, God. I like the way you dance. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Here's what I want you to do. Go through stuff. His love never changes. So quit looking back. Those things that are haunting you will haunt you no more. You're going to be free. You're going to walk into rooms and places and your smile is going to light up the room. You no longer will walk with your face down. Downcasted. You're no longer just gonna wander and cruise through life without purpose. God is gonna put the smile back in your face. He's gonna put trust back in your heart. That's it. God wants to put trust back in your heart. Will you surrender to Him? Will you say, God, this thing that is causing me to worry about the past and look at my back and worry about, I mean, I don't know where it is, but Lord, I just want to give it to you and I want trust again. You know, it's so hard. It's so hard to walk around worried, looking around. But God is going to restore trust and identity in you. And you're going to be able to walk around here carefree. Because everything that you're longing for, you're going to find it in Him. And the rest doesn't matter. Because I trust Him. You surrender to Him. Amen. Father, I thank you, Jesus, for surrender. I thank you, God. I thank you, Jesus, that you're launching her forward. Those arrows that have penetrated the heart, they've been in their way too long. Holy Spirit, pull them out one by one. One by one. Though it may be painful, joy of the Lord comes in the morning. Pull it out. Anger, pull it out. Resentment, pull it out. Forgiveness, pull it out. God says you don't have to feel like you're an imposter anymore. You don't have to walk around here thinking that you're an imposter. You are a daughter of the King. Don't let feelings tell you otherwise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you for restoration. Thank you for being our Redeemer. We love you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I'll preach a little bit. I'm going to preach a little bit. Y'all can sit down now. Thank you guys so much for hanging in there. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, praise and worship team. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Is there like a designated stand? I don't want to. Okay, I just didn't want to take all that stuff off, but okay, that works. Thank you, Jesus. You guys for coming out. You guys got nothing else to do on a Friday night? Yeah, I need some friends or what? I'm so glad to be in the house of God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, brother. I appreciate you. God is so good to us. I love the Lord. I love His presence. I love His people. You can't love God without loving His people. Don't fool yourself. That's just, this is the dynamic of the kingdom. What God does in you, He's going to do through you. Okay? So you can't love God without loving His people. Amen? And it's funny because when God gets a hold of you and His love really becomes part of your spiritual DNA, it's not really hard to love others. Because, you know, sometimes you have you ever thought about, man, man, it's really hard to love so-and-so. But, but I just have to, you know. I just have to because the Lord told me I have to. You know, that mentality is immature. It's an immature mentality. I'm going to love somebody because I have to. What we really should say is because the Lord loves me, I can love others. I get to love others. Because you have been redeemed. You have been transformed. You're born again. You get to love others. I get it. They're hard to love sometimes. I'm hard to love sometimes. That's my wife. That was just a little humor, guys. Man. Y'all are all like super spiritual. Y'all don't even laugh in the house. Sometimes we're hard to love. But the Word of God says that if we just love the people that are easy to love, is you know, what is that? What do we gain from that? How are we advancing the kingdom that way? Right? If we're going to advance the kingdom, we have to let His love go into dark places. You know what I mean? That's not even what I'm talking about today. I thank you, Jesus. Look, I'm so glad that you guys are here tonight. I'm so glad that we're doing this. That we are gathering together, that we are looking for the presence of God, that we are looking for God's guidance over our lives, that, you know, you could be doing anything right now. There's so many other things you possibly could be doing, you know, shows you could be watching, restaurants you could be eating at, places you could be visiting, maybe not so much, right? If you had a mask, you could. But you're here tonight, and the Lord is going to fill you up because of your appetite for Him. Because you're faithful to be in the house of God. Because, you know, man, we're not, the church is not in need of people who are smarter. We don't need more gifted people or talented people. The church don't need all that. It's been had that. What it needs is hungry people. That's what we need more of. People who are hungry. We got gifted people. We got people that are talented. We people that can, you know, and I'm not saying, you know, we got a great presence. I'm not devaluing what happens during worship. Obviously, please, if you're going to sing, at least hold a note. You know what I mean? If you're going to sing on the praise and worship team, we do want you to have some sort of talent. You don't want me leading worship. All right? Although technically, that's what we're doing. You know? Just not singing it. We're administrating the worship of God. But you don't want, we thank you, Lord, for Amy's voice. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. But there's more debt to her than that. Yeah. And I'm thankful for that, right? Amen. So We have talent and we have depth. But there's places that only have talent or gifts or knowledge without any depth. Am I saying that word right? Because I don't want to say like debt, like I owe you something, you know what I mean? But we are going to talk about that. But depth. Not shallow. Is that the same thing? Unshallow, not shallow. I'm going to get it right. You know, God is funny. God is so funny. He picks a guy who, my English is my second language, okay? Isn't it funny? Why didn't he just pick a white guy to preach in English? You know what I mean? He picks people like me, like Pastor Emmanuel, right? Pastor Emmanuel and I were talking about it. Like, we need somebody. Where's your husband? He needs to come back, because if I get, he was going to correct my, when I say words wrong, like people's names in the Bible wrong, he was going to help me. He needs to come back. Pastor Emmanuel was like, me too, right? But the thing is this, guys, that God wasn't looking for somebody that was gifted or eloquent, right? He wasn't looking for somebody that had talent. He was looking for somebody that would say, yes, Lord, yes. Yes, I'm good with it. Yeah, I might look silly. Yeah, I might look funny. I might mess up words, which I'm going to do it tonight, I promise you. But I'm saying yes to God. I say yes. I yield to the Spirit of God and say, yes, however you want it to look like, let that be. If you want me to try to do a backflip, Lord, I'll do it. You better anoint that. Boy, I better have a close relationship with the Lord if I'm going to attempt that. You know, test of faith right there. I come out of the other side of that thing purified gold, right, man? Woo! Are you guys believers in the house? Amen. Yeah. Praise God. Tomorrow there better be some people that don't believe in Jesus. I want this place tomorrow, okay? I want unbelievers in the house. So when they leave, they're believers with us. Amen? Tomorrow we're gonna focus on Pastor Alex is going to bring the pure gospel. Amen? The pure gospel. And so we need to pack this house out for him. Amen? Because if you hear the gospel, it will still edify you. It will. As a matter of fact, I love the gospel, don't you? I love hearing the message of the cross. Because I need to be reminded, right, what this whole thing is all about in the first place. But it will be so, it will be, it is the heart of God, amen, for the unbeliever to come into the grace of God, amen? So tomorrow, you know, I love being in the presence of the Lord. I love being with you guys. I love breakout, right? But let's shift our mentality into becoming somebody else's breakout, right? And I know your pastor's heart. We don't want to show up this whole weekend just to simply fall out a couple nights. Come on. I don't. I want the Lord to shift, amen, our culture, because I believe this, and I know you guys will agree with me, that a healthy church, I gotta be careful how I say this. Lord, help me. It's not that we don't have a church that is thriving, okay? But that church, when it's thriving, it needs to take this next step, right, in the plan of God. And the healthy church is winning souls. That is what this thing is all about. So pack the house out tomorrow for Alex. He is going to preach the gospel. Amen. And those people that don't know the Lord, your neighbor, your family, your friends, random person at Walmart, they need to know that the power of God is in this house. Amen. And that there's hope for them. Okay. Okay. Thank you, Pastor. And thank you guys for agreeing with me. The rest of you guys, just y'all get a little more excited next time. I'm going to ask you a question
Well, how many of you guys like water parks? You guys like water parks? It's been a while since I've gone to a water park. My kids are little, so we're like splash pad season, you know? It's like there's no point in going to the water park because, I mean, I can't go ride the rides because I got to watch the kids. The kids can't ride the rides because they're too little to ride the rides. So we just go to the splash pad, right? Which I love the splash pad. I mean, the water's just as cold, you know? So the splash pad's cool. But one of the, when, I remember when I used to go to the water parks back when I was growing up, they had like a Splash Town. There was another one. I'm trying, was it Water World? Yeah, the one with Astro World. Yes, it was Water World. And those, Slitterbond, yeah, that, before they had one in Galveston, you had to like drive, for, like seemed like forever just to go get wet, right? And it was funny. But one of my favorite thing, my favorite, it's not even really a ride, but I love the Lazy River, right? You guys love the Lazy River. It's just, I don't gotta do nothing. I just chill. I just get in the water, and I think they had tubes there that you could just kind of grab randomly, and you just lay in it, and you just go around in circles. That's all. If you don't know what a lazy river is, that's all it is. It's just a pool that it looks like a river, and you're going around in circles, usually around the whole park, and it's cool. I like it. That was my thing. I'm not a very strong swimmer, so the lazy river was good with me. You know, I knew that if I fell, I was just probably gonna touch the ground, you know, or something like that. So I was cool with the Lazy River. But you know, the Lazy River is at Splash Town. The Lazy River is at Water World. What's that other cool one that you guys always go to? What is it? The Splashway. Do they have a Lazy River? Yeah? Yes? It's there. But the Lazy River is not God's river. You can't just jump in there with a tube, okay, and expect God to use you. Come on, break that. The river of God is not for lazy people. Come on now. The river of God is not for those who like to sit on their blessed assurance. The river of God is not for those who have enough of God. Don't raise your hand. The river of God, okay, is not just to get you comfortable until you get to heaven. That's not the God that we serve. That is not the plan of God. So, if today you're a born-again believer, and you are lazy, comfortable. Is it all right if I step on some toes tonight? I'm sorry. I mean, if you guys don't have, bring, want me to preach again, that's fine, but I'm going to get through tonight. It's the thing about the river of God. Look, I was saying that if you are a believer, if you're born again, then you signed up, and some of you guys don't even know what you signed up for. In other words, you didn't even really count the cost. You just jumped on board because it felt good. And when the river changed speeds, you still want to tell you, you still want to just float the lazy river. Let me tell you, that's the mentality that we have to shift from. That I signed up way back when, and that was good enough. When there's a dying world destined for hell, while you and I sit here and talk about it, and talk about it, and talk about it, and talk about it, and it is targeting my intellect really well. I understand it, but my heart is hard. But the word of God and the mission of God is not penetrating my heart. I understand it here. I've been talking about it since Sunday school, since kids' church. I know the mission here, but it has not dropped down to here. Yeah. Guess I'm not used to wearing glasses. I just about knocked them off. You guys like my glasses? Do I look hipster? He's trying to look hipster. Because apparently that's like where the anointing flows. Jeans could be a little tighter. Dear Lord. Oh. I guess they want to like squeeze the anointing out of you. Yeah. Are you a believer? Then you signed up. And if you're not doing anything, you didn't count the cost. You just showed up to the party empty-handed. And guess what? When the party ends and the fat lady sings, don't look around. When the fat lady sings, and God calls this thing to a wrap, He's going to look at your life and He's going to say, who are you? You snuck in through the back or something. I don't know who you are. My Lord, my Lord. Because you've been taking space in the kingdom and producing no fruit whatsoever for a long time. Peter, away. Bye. We have to understand what it is that we actually signed up for. You signed up to be a missionary for Jesus. Every single one of us in this place, we know it here. Tonight I want to drop down here. Today I'm going to read you scriptures that are not new. I hope that doesn't surprise you. But God does want to do something new. Right? Luke 14:28-30 says this. For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it, lest after he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Have you counted the cost? Do you know what you signed up for? Yeah, I remember last time I preached, whenever that was, I made a statement, and I've been thinking about it a lot. But, you know, back in the Church of Acts, people were not allowed in the community until after they got saved. They didn't bring them to the community so they could get saved. They brought them into the church after they got saved. And the funny thing is that people would sneak in. They would sneak in to the meetings and kind of be like spies. You know what I mean? They would just kind of serve. And you can read it through the Gospels. And then also Paul talks about it a lot in his letters, right? That there were false prophets. Spies have come in, right, to eavesdrop on what's going on and to try to steer people in another direction, right? So the thing is this, and I don't know how they did it, right? I don't know how they kept up. I guess they all just really knew each other, spent so much time. They're like, oh, this is Alex, and I know he's a believer, you know? And then somebody that came that wasn't, hey, who are you? Yeah, we don't know you, right? You've never been part of this community. And I don't know how I'm just making stuff up because that's just how my brain works, right? when we were pastoring in Rochelle, right next to us, there was a game room, right? And one day I was like, you know what, I'm going to go. And I forgot if I was going to take something over there. Or I don't know what it was. And I opened that first door, and I thought I was going to step right into the game room. And I stepped in, and there was another door. And you couldn't see nothing. It had this little window. And there was like cameras pointed at me. And then you had to ring the doorbell. It was like I stepped in from, I just thought I was going to step in right into the game room, you know? I said, hear all those little noise. I didn't. I stepped in, and there was another door right in front of me. It's like I almost hit it. I'm like, oh, okay. So I'm sitting there waiting. Finally, somebody comes in. Whoosh. I can only see this part of it. Yeah, exactly. Can I help you? I'm from next door. And they're like, uh-huh. And they're like, this is for members only. And I'm like, oh. Well, I'm not a member, but I mean, I just kind of want to talk to you guys. And they're like, no, this is for members only. And you have to show them your card or they won't let you in, right? So
I kind of picture that happening. You know what I mean? I know it didn't, but it's like, it's like, hey, who are you? This thing is for believers only. Sold out, on fire, believers. Amen. This is not a club. It's not a group of people that I just so happen to fall together. Listen, God puts people together with a purpose. Amen. You didn't just come in here and fall in place because the AC feels good. It does feel good in here. Thank you, Lord, for the AC, right? You might have shown up. Maybe you like the pastor. Praise God. Our pastor's awesome. Amen. But there's more to it than that. We have to tap into that. I hope you counted the cost when you showed up, when you signed up. I want to read from Proverbs today. I want to talk a little bit about laziness. Is that all right? I get to preach one time anyways. If I don't come back, it'll be all right. But I'll come back. Maybe not preach, but I'll be back in this. I might be sick. Why don't you just work the camera, boy? Hey, Josh, I'm coming for your job, man. Can I work the camera? You gonna teach me? Thank you for working the camera. I still think it's weird to talk to the camera. Hello. Let's read, amen, from Proverbs chapter 6, verse 1. I'm reading the New King James Version today. It says, my son, if you become sorority, or in other words, if you co-sign. How many of you guys ever co-sign for somebody, right? Man, praise God. Yeah, I was like, woof. Eh, kind of risky, right? Kind of risky. Sorority? Hey, white boy, am I saying that right? Quit texting. What is it? Surety. My son, if you become surety for your friend, if you have shaken hands and pledged for a stranger, you are snared by the words of your mouth. You are taken by the words of your mouth. So do this, my son, and deliver yourself. For you have come into the hand of your friend. Go and humble yourself. Plead with your friend. Give no sleep to your eyes, nor slumber to your eyelids. Deliver yourself like a gazelle from the hand of the hunter, and like a bird from the hand of the fowler. Go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise, which having no captain, overseer, or ruler, provides her supplies in the summer and gathers her food in the harvest. How long will you slumber, O sluggard? When will you rise from your sleep? A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall your poverty come on you like a prowler, and your need like an armed man. Let's stop right there for just a second. Last time I read my Bible, when we said yes to God, we became slaves to God. Paul calls himself a slave of God numerous times throughout his writings. Amen. When we say, yes, Lord, we are saying, God, you are in control. Amen. In other words, I have been bought with a price. And so from now on, I am under the service of God himself. Amen. No one else but God's, not even my own. So I am in debt to God. And if I am in debt to God, then I should be working, amen, to try to repay him for what he has done. You will never be able to do that. But there should be a stirring and a hunger, and you should be so to the place of loving him in gratitude that you are ready to do what he says, when he says it, how he says it, without a question. Are you following what I'm saying? There should be a longing, what's that word I'm looking for? That's a great word to use. Thank you. I can say that one. Desire. There should be a desire, a burning desire to please the Lord. If that desire is not there today, then you don't know my God. I don't know who you're serving. Some of you guys are filled with the Spirit. I don't know what spirit you got filled with, because my spirit, the spirit that I'm filled with, says this. Okay? This is what the Bible says about my Holy Spirit. It says that he shall come upon me, and I shall be filled with power, and I'm going to step out of my comfort zone and preach the gospel all to all the world. Did you sign up for the baptism of the Holy Ghost? Then you're a missionary of that controller. You are a missionary of that Lord. You are now his property. We don't like that. We don't like that. We don't like those words. I don't want to be anybody's property. Then you didn't count the cost. You just showed up because the music was good, which it is. And I'm so grateful for that. You just showed up because somebody tickled your ear. You just showed up because you like the new carpet. You guys like the new carpet?
Yeah.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. We didn't count the cost. Let's talk a little bit about, I shouldn't have done this. Print forward, you know, on both sides. Yeah, it's tricky. Have you committed to something? Are you committed to the gospel of Jesus? Are you here saying, God, control me, send me, do whatever it is that you want with my life? Or are we here to sit and warm up a chair until the next service, until the next service, until the next service, and never really give control to God? You see, we cry at these altars all day long that we surrender our lives to the Lord. We give you everything, Jesus. And then we come back, and the first time somebody looks at us the wrong way, we get offended. I thought you were surrendered. I thought you surrendered it all, like your emotions and your anger. I love how Brother Ravenhill says it. He says, you know, people said they're saved. What are they saved from? Are they saved from their anger? Are they saved from their lust? Are they saved from their alcoholism? What are you really saved from? That sounds good to say that I'm saved. What are you saved from? What did you sign up for? What did you sign up to? This thing, it's not, the thing about working for the Lord and going on, being a missionary for the Lord, being called of God, is that it's not optional. You don't get to pick. The only decision you get to make is whether you want the Lord or not. And when you say yes to the Lord, everything else is on him. He gives you your job description. You don't get to make it up. See, the thing, Pastor, is that some of us, we're still waiting for the call of God. He's already said go.
That's right.
He's already bought the ticket on the cross. So what are we waiting for? Sometimes I feel like, you know, we're Jewish waiting for the Messiah. The Messiah already showed up. And he's already done left. So that means that the Spirit came. And if the Spirit is in you, then you should go out and tell the whole world. Because that's what the Spirit is there for, to empower that. See, the thing is that the Spirit of God will come and empower us. But it's a prayer life that maintains that power. The Holy Spirit comes and empowers us, but the move of God is maintained not by the heebie-jeebies, but by the discipline of prayer.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let me get back over here. In Luke chapter 7, verses 36 through 50, I'm going to kind of skip down to what's happening. There's a, you know what, I'm not going to do that because the Lord shared some stuff with me that I want to share with you guys. In Luke chapter 7, verse 36, I want to show you guys a picture of what it looks like, amen, of a person that has been forgiven and it's willing to do whatever. There is a passion, a burning desire to please Jesus. Amen? And the funny thing is that there's a Pharisee. So let's start in verse 1. I'm going to read you guys a couple of scriptures and then we'll kind of go from there. It says, then one of the Pharisees asked him to eat with him. Asked Jesus, right? And he went to the Pharisee's house and sat down to eat. And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil and stood at his feet behind him weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair of her head. And she kissed his feet and anointed them with the fragrant oil. Now see, religion don't like that. Watch this. It says, now when the Pharisees who invited him saw this, he spoke to himself saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him. For she is a sinner. See, this guy wasn't even talking to Jesus. He wasn't. He was talking to himself. But Jesus got an answer anyways. You know what I mean? He's got an answer. He's like, well, you know, the thing is, the thing is this. Sinners is Jesus' business. So when the Pharisee religion starts talking about sinners, Jesus makes it a point to make it his business. This is my business. I know you ain't talking to me, Pharisee, but you're talking about a sinner who I came for. So that is my business. So you ain't talking to me, but I'm going to give you my answer anyways, because this is my business. You ain't going to mess with my business. I came here for this purpose. Yeah. So, and Jesus answered and said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. Now, if Jesus says that to you, you better perk up. And you're fixing to leave really sad or really glad, but nothing in between. So he said, teacher, say it. That's about the best thing that dude said the whole time. He's been sitting there at the table with Jesus. Speak, Lord. You know? There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. See, that's what I'm saying, that debt. You know, I was messing that up. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more? Simon answered and said, I suppose the one whom he forgave more. And he said to him, you have rightly judged. Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, listen, he's looking at the woman, but he's talking to Simon. Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair on her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. Gosh, help us, Lord. Yeah. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore, I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. Then he said to her, your sins are forgiven. And those who sat at the table with him began to say to themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? Then he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. That's a beautiful picture. But there's a line in the sand being drawn at this moment. Jesus is at the table with the Pharisee. And all of a sudden, this woman, as a sinner, comes in and begins to come in contact with Jesus. And the Pharisees begin to question that. They begin to question Jesus because they said, if this guy was really a prophet, then he would know who it is that is touching him. But Jesus making it his business, because sinners are his business, lost souls are his business, the sick are his business, the broken are his business, the ones that are bound are his business. He made it his business and he clarified, he made a division. He said, listen to me, okay? You who think you're right with God because you understand it here, you have not a burning passion to serve me like this woman has served me. You brought me into your house. You invited me into your church, okay? And ever since I showed up, you have not ministered unto me. He says, you have not anointed me with oil. Your tears have not fallen on my feet. Your fragrance have not been poured over my feet. You have not ministered to me. Yet this woman has ministered to me this whole time because she knows where she came from, where she's coming from. She knows that she doesn't deserve it. She knows that there's no other way. She knows that she should probably not even be alive anymore. She knows these things, but she goes to Jesus anyways, and just with this almost like this last hope, and she reaches in there and begins to make contact with Jesus, whose business is sinners, and he makes that contact, and she begins to passionately adore him and love him and minister unto him, while the Pharisee who knows it all here has not ministered to God. They never got there. They will never get there because their target is here. They don't understand it. So I am saying to you here tonight, are you a Pharisee? Has Jesus entered your house and you don't even know it? Has he entered this church and you have not even ministered to him? You got to get a hold of this. You got to get a hold of this. He's in this place tonight. Are you ministering to him? Are your tears falling? I'm not saying you got to get emotional. I'm just saying your heart better be affectionate towards him. There's got to be something happening on the inside. And when you leave this place, you leave more in love with Jesus than when you came in, so much so that I want his business to be my business. Sinners. Gotta get broken. I wanna make a few points. I just wanted to bring that to you to show you that there has been forgiveness in your life. Don't forget where you came from or you're gonna get lazy. You have been forgiven much, so you have to love much. That is the natural progression. If you are not loving much, then you don't remember how much you've been forgiven. You need a fresh dose of the power of the cross. You need to stop looking at ministry. You need to stop looking at your bank account. You need to stop looking at your neighbor and gaze on the cross of Jesus. Look at the cross. Look at the blood. Look at the broken body. Look at it. He did it for you. And you need a reminder because you're not loving much anymore. And that is the natural dynamic of the kingdom of God. I am forgiving. I'm going to love. Carry your cross. Carry your cross. I've been forgiven much. I must love much. I've been forgiven much. I must love much. Minister to the Lord. I want to make a few points. Let me see. I want to do that. I want to make a few points from
I want to go back real quick to the Proverbs 6. Because I don't want you to leave this place thinking that there's no hope for you. Or that there's that you're doing it all wrong. I don't want you to leave this place feeling that way. Unless you're doing it all wrong. Then I want the conviction of the Lord to hit you and you're transformed. But I want one of the things that it talks about in Proverbs 6 is it says give no unnecessary sleep. That's what it says. Where is it? Let me find it real quick. There he goes. It says, give no unnecessary sleep. In other words, it's not saying that you just need to stay awake all night and pray. It's okay to sleep. It's okay to rest. But it says, only what's necessary. Only what's necessary. Listen, we're going to come into seasons, spiritual seasons in your life, okay, where the river is going to allow you just to coast, okay? It's going to allow you to coast and to get some rest, to get some recharge, get refilled by the Spirit of the Lord. And he's gonna come and recharge you, right? Just like all these phones and devices that we carry around. We plug them up every night or every other night, depending on what phone you got, right? And you plug them in, and then the next day they're ready to go, right? And we have those seasons. But listen, they're plugged in only for a few hours while you're asleep or whatever. And then you grab those phones and you put them to what? To work. You put them to use, right? So it's okay to recharge, plug up, have times of revival where we come and we get recharged. But we must be used. We must be used, right? And so it's okay to sleep. Rest and laziness are two different things. Two different things. Rest has a lot to do with completion. And you own a construction business and you do fine job, sir. Apparently my wife wants you to come over and give us a quote. Yeah. Thanks. Come over. We'll cook something up and eat, and then we might talk about the house and stuff. But food's good. But I have to eat on this side. Unless it's after Monday, then maybe I can eat on that side again. Oh, yeah. That sounds good. Anything sounds about good right now. Give me a, yeah, anyways. You're in the construction business. And some of you guys have different projects that you work on or whatever. You know, it's one thing for you to take extra rest when you haven't even finished the job and you're late on your deadlines and you are not doing a good job. You've made several mistakes, which I know you don't. This is hypothetical about it. This is not true, right? And you still, you know what, I just don't think we're going to go work on that today. You know, I'm just going to kind of lay around the house, right? Watch Netflix with Amy and the kids. Yeah, blah, blah. That's laziness, right? That's different. When he meets his deadline and completes a task, then he finds rest. His mind is at rest. His body's at rest. Amy gets rest. The kids get rest. Are you following what I'm saying? The rest that comes from God, it is found in the completion of God. Have you found rest today? Have you found peace today? Has God made you whole? Has God made you complete? Do you feel his presence? Are you lacking something? Rest and laziness are different. I'm going to try to move this a little faster because I feel like I'm losing some of you guys. I like how they use the analogy of an ant. Have you guys ever watched ants? I like watching ants. They're cool. They really are. I always wanted one of those like little glass things where like the ants, what are they called? Ant farm. Yeah. I always wanted one of those. Just never got one. But they look cool. But I'm not going to get one right now because the twins will probably take a dinosaur and break it. all the ants will come out and all that. But I want you to notice something about the ant. First of all, it doesn't even have a master, and it works, right? You have a master, so how much more should we be willing to serve the Lord? But what I really want to talk about is this, that the ant is very aware of what season it is. He's very aware of what season it's in, right? Because we see that they are storing food, right? Because there's a season where it won't be there. So the ant is aware of the seasons. We should be aware of the season. We should be aware of where we are at, okay? What should we be doing? Should I be laying back or should I be moving forward? Should I be going head first or do I need to start kind of throttling back? You have to begin to identify the seasons. The worst kind of season you could be in is one that you have not even identified. Why? Well, you don't even know. You're in no man's land. You're confused. I don't even know what to do. I'm here to tell you this, that there's a season coming to this church and to this region where there's going to be an awakening, amen, of the people that are in need for God. But he's going to use you and I. For so long, he's been pouring into every single one of us. And it is time to allow him to use those things to pour out into a community. That is the season that we're entering. I want to make a couple points of what laziness leads to. And I'm going to use a little more Proverbs to go through that. I'm not going to preach very much longer than this. But when we allow laziness in our life, it leads to certain things. Laziness leads to lack. Laziness leads to lack. We just read that in Proverbs, right? Proverbs 6, that when you fold your hands, you take a break, then poverty comes into the house. In other words, when we are lazy, we begin to lack. We lack what? What do we lack? When we are lazy, the first thing I want to talk about, when we're lazy, we lack discernment and wisdom. When we are lazy, we lack discernment and wisdom. Amen. I'm going to read from the Word of God on that. It says in Proverbs chapter 20, verse 4, it reads like this. The lazy man will not plow because of winter. He will beg during harvest and have nothing. The lazy man will not plow because of winter, and he will beg during harvest and have nothing. Laziness will cloud you and not let you see, okay, what you're supposed to be doing. So when the time comes when you need to pull from the storehouse, there is nothing there. There's not wisdom leading you to begin to pull when it's time to pull. So when there's nothing there to pull and you want to grab from the storehouse, there is nothing there and you're just begging, but there's nothing there for you. Laziness leads to the lack of wisdom and discernment. Amen. Let me tell you something. There is things in your life that are attacking you, that are keeping you bound, that are keeping you sidetracked from the will of God, but you cannot see them because you're stuck on laziness and you're not willing to spend time with the Lord, to spend time in prayer, to spend time in the Word of God. And because of your laziness, you cannot see those things that are harming you. You just think that this is normal life, that the normal Christian life allows you to be in depression, that the normal Christian life allows you to be bound, that the normal Christian life allows you to have struggles active in your life. But those things, you cannot see them because you have been lazy and you are not sharpened and your vision is not focused. Because laziness brings a lack into your house, into your life. Lack of discernment. When Adam and Eve disobeyed, right? Lack entered the house. Lack entered. Where they had everything they've ever needed. God was providing every need. Not just physically, food, things like that. Emotionally, spiritually, they were whole. And the fall came, and they were no longer complete. We must deal, okay, with laziness in our life because it leads to lack. I don't need to tell you guys this stuff. It's biblical principles, but you also see it in your life a lot, don't you? The grass doesn't cut itself. I wish it did. It does not. You want a pretty yard? You got to go work on it. You want to bring food to the table? You got to go to work. You want a nice this, nice that? You got to go to work. You got to work for it. Lazy people don't have things. And if they do, I'm gonna jump back. It's not my business. Let's keep going. Laziness leads to lack. First thing I said was laziness leads to lack of discernment and wisdom. The second thing that laziness leads to lack of is lack of influence and reliability. Lack of influence and reliability. Listen, nobody cares what you have to say because you ain't got no fruit. You ain't got nothing to show for. About a year and a half ago, a little longer maybe, I don't know, I weigh 235 pounds. If I came to you and gave you my diet plan and my workout regimen, you best not follow it because you're going to be 235 pounds, which is a lot for a guy my size, right? You ain't going to follow what I say. Why? Because that ain't no fruit. I mean, if it's a fruit, it's a watermelon and it's big. You follow what I'm saying? You ain't going to listen to me. Why? Because there's lack. Things don't add up. No evidence. Laziness leads to lack of evidence in your life. And no wonder your loved ones are still lost. There's no evidence. They ain't got nothing different than I got. Yet they spend all this time at church. I just save on gas and stay here. It's the same thing. They act the same as I do. They talk the same way. They're still bound to depression like I am. They still need this drug, that alcohol, that thing so they can relax. Well, what's the difference? There's no fruit. See, laziness brings in the lack of influence in your life. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 26 says this. As vinegar to the teeth and smoke to the eyes, so is the lazy man to those who send him. I hate sitting by the fire and the smoke gets in your eye. And you're just like, I hate. That's like, Lord, I thought you said you loved us. Like, you want me to go blind by the fire? You know what I mean? It's like the smoke hits and you're like, ah. And you're just like, ah, you just gotta walk into the fire, right? But some of you guys just are smarter than me, so you probably just kind of stay still, right? But for some reason, for me to get my sight back, I gotta go walk around like crazy. I hate that feeling, don't you? It's like, man, the fire's so nice. I love sitting by the fire. Well, not right now, but I guess not really. It doesn't really get cold enough around here. But we just light a fire anyways. You know what I mean? We're sweating, shorts and a t-shirt in the winter, but we got a fire going, right? And it's fun to sit by the fire. That smoke hits you. It's not pleasant. It ruins the fire and the s'mores. It ruins the warmth
And the light that is shining all of a sudden just hits me, and I'm like, ah. Laziness. A lazy person is like the smoke in your eyes. You're ruining the fire. God is trying to light a fire in Brazoria County, and he wants to use you, but you're lazy, and you're just like the smoke coming out of the fire into somebody's eye instead of the warmth, instead of the light, instead of the service that the fire provides. You're just the smoke, and you hurt. Get out of the way. That's... I don't know. Have you guys ever tried vinegar? That's weird. Some of you guys have, apparently. I think, isn't jalapenos have like vinegar, like pickled jalapenos, right? So I guess I gotta try that. Does that count? But they're not that bad. But apparently vinegar all by itself is. Because anybody testify to that, you're like, nah, you're okay, cool. So laziness leads to a lack of influence and reliability. Laziness leads to a lack of contentment. Ain't that the truth? I don't got what I want, but I ain't gonna do nothing to get it. And I ain't happy with nothing, but I ain't gonna go do nothing about getting it. If you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always gotten. You're lazy, you get lazy fruit, right? Proverbs 13:4 says this, the soul of a lazy man desires and has nothing, but the soul of the diligent shall be made rich. Laziness leads to the lack of rest. Proverbs 26:14 says this, as a door turns on its hinges, so does the lazy man on his bed. You can't even get rest. It's lazy. You know, some of the best times, some of the times where I got the best rest is after a long day. It's been a long, hard day. I've been going and going and going, and it seems like it's so easy to go to bed, right? But then there's those other days where I have done absolutely nothing, and I ain't even tired, and it's dark, and I'm supposed to be asleep, but I'm sitting there wide awake, right? Because, listen, my body ain't tired, and my mind is racing, because guess what? It didn't do nothing, right? I just kind of lazied around all day. And so when we're lazy, okay, then that we lack true rest, because there's no completion. Do you understand what you have signed up for? Do you understand the gem and the value of the gospel of Jesus? I am challenging you here tonight with everything that I've said is to try to help us see that there's got to be a culture change in the way that we are doing Christianity. We have not count the cost. We are showing up and going back home, and we ain't dragging nobody with us to heaven. We are coming in here and we are getting blessed, and it feels good, and I go back home, and I come back, and I do it again, and I go back home, and I come back, and I do it again, and I go back home, and the kingdom of God is becoming stagnant because nobody is advancing it. Nobody is moving forward. We got so much of God, it's almost like we're spiritual gluttons. It's like we're spiritual gluttons. We're so selfish with the presence of God that we want to be in it 24/7. You can, but you have to understand that the presence of God is not here to give you this life of rose petals and rest and you just get to walk around in cloud nine. Let me tell you something. When I read the word of God, of the men and women who were filled by the Holy Spirit, they had trials, there was persecution, there was all kinds of things coming against them. Why? Because they were doing something. We don't experience persecution because we're not doing anything to be persecuted for. We're not getting persecuted. Why? I ain't doing nothing. It's like, you know, we always tell kids, right? Like, or you know, I know at work when I was an apprentice, and you mess up. You know, you're learning. You mess up when you're learning, don't you? And, you know, and the guy that you were working with, if he was a nice guy, he would tell you, no, it's all right, you know. You know, if you weren't doing nothing, you wouldn't mess up. In other words, saying, it's like, hey, at least you're doing something, right? Hey, listen, if you ain't doing nothing, you ain't going to experience no persecution. Your life is not going to look like that of the book of Acts. What is there to persecute you about? That you're wearing a hoodie with Jesus' name on it? Okay. Wow, you're so bright in the darkness. You're wearing a hoodie with Jesus' name on it. Oh, my gosh. Earth shaking. I mean, come on. The thing is this. Laziness is a fruit of selfishness. Laziness is a fruit of selfishness. I love me more than I love the kingdom of God. I know I'm preaching hard to you. I know I am. But I'm not going to stop. Because God is trying to do something in us. And we are accountable to administrate the move of God. But before God moves in the way he wants to move, he is going to prepare his vessels. And he can't prepare a vessel that is not willing, amen, to say, I am here, Lord, send me. I don't want God to, I mean, I do want God to send Alex, but I don't want him just to send Alex, right? We get so excited. I'm so tired of people getting excited because God is using other people. What should excite you is God is using me. That's where we need to move to. Yes, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, my gosh, they're so good. Praise God. I hope God uses them. No, God, use me. If you, listen, if God can use me, boy, he's going to use you. He can definitely use you. I would just trust me. Just trust me. There's a shift that needs to happen. There's a shift that needs to happen. You see, here's the deal. You have to really value and change your mind about Jesus and the gospel and the mission of the gospel. That has to be something you truly, truly value. You have to fall in love with it. You know, we need to get to the point where we really see the gospel for the gem that it is, for the diamond, for that beautiful, priceless thing that has been entrusted to you and I. The thing is this, that I'm not going to put any effort into something I don't value, right? I mean, just think about it. That we can apply that to everyday life. I mean, what are some things that I don't put? I never went out and bought a baseball bat. I like watching it, but not to the point where I want to go and learn all the details about it. That's Jordan's job. That's his deal. You know what I mean? It's not mine. I don't care. I mean, you know, I like spike ball. I haven't gone out and bought a spike ball set. I'm not that committed to it. Right? Spike ball's fun. I don't have a spike ball set. I like Jeeps. I don't own one. I'm just not that committed to it. It's not what I value. I like it. just not enough to go in debt for it. You follow what I'm saying? If we don't value something, we don't work for it. You see, and I gotta be careful how I say this because I want you to pay your bills. We're more committed to the bank than we are to Jesus. I sure meet them notes. I don't want to miss them because I don't want them to take my materials. I don't want them to take my material things. But yet here we are, more committed to a bank than we are to Jesus. I work and work and work, and I go to work, and I wake up on time, and I'm on time, and I do what they ask me to do, and I go home, and I do it again the next day. Why? Because I owe the bank something, and I value those things that I owe them for, right? And so I work and work and work to make sure that those things get paid, yeah? What you work at reveals where your value is. Let's read in 1 Peter. Let's talk about, I just want to show you how valuable the gospel is. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. And I'm wrapping up. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. To in an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at what? At the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love. Though now you do see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressibly and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your soul. I like those words that he uses, inheritance, incorruptible, undefiled, right? That does not perish, genuineness, precious. And I like that last part. It says, receiving the end of your faith. The end of your faith. The salvation of your souls. The end of your faith. The end of it. As we begin to, now I realize, so the Lord is working in us today, all of us. In this message, I pray that you receive it with an open heart. And I pray that you allow God to speak to your heart. And I pray that it challenges what is it that you value most. I pray that God will replay, right, your last few days, your last few weeks, your last few months, and show you what is it that you are valuing more. What are you working for? What are you striving for? What is it that has your attention? What is it that has your affection? And I want God to challenge us to the place where it breaks us, to the place where we move from a place of laziness or content or just that a comfort into a place where we set ourselves to be prepared and launched, amen, into the true meaning of being a believer of Jesus. What we have been doing is not enough. How do I know that? Look around. Look around. You don't have to go very far. Look behind you. Look next to you. There is empty chairs. That means that what we've been doing over and over and over again is not working. There must be something different, something new that God does in you, because what He wants to do in you, He wants to do through you. But if you think that you are okay, if you think that there's no work to be done, if you are tired of hearing my voice, if you are tired of hearing the words lazy, if you are tired of hearing the word Jesus, if you are tired of hearing the value of the gospel, then there might just be a slight chance that God is trying to wake you up, to shake you up, to use you to administrate the next move of God. But you cannot keep doing what you've always done, because what you've always done is not working anymore. And if it's working to a certain extent, God wants to magnify it, intensify it, and that's going to take surrender. That's going to take counting the cost. I believe that today is a day where you have to make a decision, where you are going to have to make the choice. Do I keep doing what I've always done, even though it doesn't work, even though it doesn't fulfill the mission of Christ? I like my blessed assurance. I got all of God that I want. I don't need any more. Preacher, you can keep your gospel because I got all I need. And if that is you tonight, you are being brought to a point of decision. You are making a choice today. You will make a choice today, whether you express it or not. You're either going to say, Lord, use me. I want to recount the cost. I am recalculating things. I am looking at the price, and I am looking at the work, and I am looking at what it takes to follow you, and I'm stepping back. And this life that I've been living that has not produced any fruit, I'm evaluating that. And after you have evaluated the call of God, if after you have evaluated what it means to be born again, which is to go be doers of the word and be proclaimers of the gospel and be missionaries to a lost world, after you have recalculated all that and taken that into perspective, after you have looked in your life and looked if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, if you speak with the evidence of other and with tongues, if you operate in the gifts of the Spirit, if you claim the Holy Spirit is in you, then there should be a passion, a desire, and a burden for the lost. And you look at all those things and you still say, you know what? I still want to follow Jesus, then it's time for change. Yes. After you evaluated all of that and you said Jesus is still worth it, then that means you can't keep doing what you've been doing. It's like you're on a boat right now, and the sail is set. But the winds are changing. The winds are changing. And today, you're either going to let that sail ride and let God redirect you, or you're going to put that sail right up and keep coasting the way that you've always done, with no fruit and no value for the gospel of God, for the gospel of Jesus, with no passion, no fire. I'm not saying you don't love the excitement of worship. I'm not saying you don't come up here and pray and lay hands on the sick, lay hands on those who are being prayed for. I'm not saying that you don't minister within this church. I'm not saying that. Thank you for serving within the church. But the mission is outside of the church. This is equipping That is the mission. Yeah. This is where we come and get filled. That is where we get poured out. If you are stuck in the pouring, it is almost like you're a broken record. You are just going and playing the same thing, the same thing, the same thing. And guess what? That sound is getting old. That sound is getting old. It's time to change the record and play a new tune. One that will truly make this community dance. They're so tired of our demonstration of the gospel that they want nothing to do with it. That's what they're looking for. A demonstration is going to come through us. Through saying yes to the change of the winds of God. Amen? Let's stand together. We're going to open these altars. Listen, we must get in these altars. We need to get in these altars today. We need to repent. We need to seek God. We need to say, God, forgive me for being lazy. Forgive me for being complacent. And after calculating everything, God, I still say yes to you. That is what we need to do tonight. That is the call tonight. God needs to draw you to an altar where you die again and you say yes to the gospel after counting the cost. Father, we repent for this watered-down gospel that we have been living in. Father, we repent for our selfishness. We repent for our spiritual, how shallow we are. And Holy Spirit, I ask right now that you convict us all, that you bring us under the conviction of God, a conviction that will transform us and set us ablaze for you, God. Will you send us, Jesus? Lord, we're longing to see this community that is broken, that is hurting, that is lost. We want to see them come to you, God. But I know, Jesus, that I personally have not been doing my part. I come to church, I get a touch from you, God, and I do nothing with it. I hide my light. I fall asleep at my post. But today, God, I want you to do a new thing in me. I want you to shatter my ideas and take control. I want more. I want genuine. I really do want the gospel, Jesus. I want to say yes to all of it, not just the parts that I like. Father, I want to come home with stories to tell to my wife and my children about how you used me that day, about a soul that I ministered to and got saved, about a sick body that was healed. I want to be able to tell those stories. Will you fill us up, Jesus? Will you fill us up, Lord? I want to invite you to
fill these altars. He's in this house and we need to minister to Him. He's in this house and we need to weep at His feet. We need to pour out our fragrance, our values, our things at His feet. Don't be like the Pharisee who wants to invite Jesus over for dinner but never minister to Him. But never worship Him, never surrender to Him, never sit at His feet. I want people to see that I'm with Jesus, but I don't want to serve Him. Do it, God. Father, do it your way. This thing doesn't have to be pretty. It doesn't have to be with a bow and a box. It's okay if the winds are rough, Lord. If my heart needs to be shattered. If it hurts, God. It doesn't have to be pretty. It doesn't have to be roses and dandelions, Lord. It's okay if it's full of sorrow and tears and persecution. God, it's okay if nobody prophesies over me. You're in the room and you're enough. God, it's okay if nobody gives me a prophetic word. Your word is enough. Lord, it's okay if I don't feel it or if it's late. I value you, Lord. We value you in this place, Jesus. We value you, Lord. Take us out of our broken religion into the pure gospel. One that is focused on Jesus, Holy Ghost empowered, and set ablaze on a mission for souls.
Shekinah glory come, Shekinah. Shekinah glory come.
Did you hear the alarm from heaven go off today? The alarm has gone off. The wake-up call has been given. We can leave this place and still giving Jesus your yes after recounting the cost. Or you can just put yourselves away and keep drifting the same way you've always done. Now, I was here to kind of beat you up a little bit. But Alex, tomorrow, he's going to lift you guys back up. Alex is preaching tomorrow. He's going to be preaching the gospel. So you get to practice between tonight and tomorrow night. You get to practice truly being born again. And really moving with the vision and the mission of heaven. And there's another opportunity, right? I mean, you want to come talk about that a little bit? Or? Yeah.
God's good. Amen. Guillermo said something earlier in his message that really, you know, rang very true in my heart. And he said, you know, a healthy church is a church about winning souls. Amen? You know, the Bible says, for this purpose, Jesus came to seek and to save those that were lost. Amen? And if the Spirit of God's living inside of us, there should be something in us that compels us to reach the lost. Amen? We were all lost at one point. So I want to give you guys an opportunity to come and partner with us and be part of an outreach opportunity tomorrow morning. Amen. I know it's Saturday morning. Who likes to sleep in on Saturday morning? But what did we just read about? Extra sleep. Right? Anyway, there's going to be several of us going to be here at 9 o'clock in the morning. We're going to have flyers, and we're going to be going into this community right behind the church. A lot of you are familiar with it. We've been going there Thanksgiving after Thanksgiving, Christmas after Christmas, just planting seeds of love. And we're going to invite people to the remaining services of the revival, as well as take any opportunity the Holy Spirit gives us to demonstrate the love of God to those who need it. Amen? So I want to challenge you. Set your alarms. Wake up a little earlier. Give up a little bit of sleep. Sacrifice a little bit. Amen? And let's go out there and love people into the kingdom. Let the love of God compel them to the kingdom. Amen? It's not about how good you can smile at them or how eloquent you can speak. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that leads men to repentance. Amen? So all we're doing is being vessels, going out there in love and letting God's goodness do the rest of the work. Amen? It's the Spirit that's going to draw them in. Is everyone on the same page? Awesome. So yeah, tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock, we're going to go out there, 9 to 12, and we're just going to evangelize. Amen? Tomorrow night is Salvation Night. It's a night of breakout, and we want you guys to bring in the lost. Wave your hand up if you know someone that needs Jesus. Amen? We all have those people in our lives. Co-workers, family members, you know, friends. Bring them to church, all right? Even if you got to pay them $20 to get here, I don't know, bait them. Tell them, hey, I'll buy you a meal afterwards, right? I'll pay for your gas. I don't know what you got to do. Be creative. Ask God, Lord, what can I do to get this person into church? But I just want to say, don't sleep on it, okay? Get them here tomorrow night. We want people to be exposed to the gospel. Amen? The Bible says it's foolishness to those that are perishing, but it's the power of God to those that believe it. Amen? So anyway, be here tomorrow at 9 o'clock, and then be here tomorrow at 6. 6 o'clock's the service tomorrow night. Amen. All right, I guess we'll dismiss. Father God, we thank you for tonight. Lord, I thank you for your word that's gone forth in this place. Lord, your word never returns void, Lord God. And Lord, tonight your word cuts some of us. Lord God, you speak with the intent to bring healing and wholeness. So Lord God, I pray that we would act upon the word of God tonight, not just be hearers, but that we would leave this place and be appliers of the word, Lord. That we would begin to be faithful with the things you've placed in our hands. Lord God, that we would begin to acquire discipline, that we'd begin to acquire, Lord, a pursuit of your heart, Lord God. Lord, because I know, Lord, that if we begin to be faithful with what you've given us, Lord, you're going to bring the more. And that's where you're wanting to take us as a church. That's where you're wanting to take us as a body, as individuals. You want to give us the more. You want to give us the more. But we have to begin to be faithful with what's in our hands already. So, Father God, I thank you that we're not a lazy people. But, Lord, we're people about the kingdom's business. Jesus said that he always did what he saw the Father doing. Lord, you're always working. You're always doing something. And you're calling us to be about your business in this region. I thank you that there's work to be done. But, Lord God, that you've equipped us with everything we need, Lord, to see the harvest won. We thank you for it, Lord. We thank you for your goodness. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would come and just seal everything you've done tonight. Lord, let your people sleep well and let them be ready for tomorrow. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.